Hi, I'm Jeff Furman, and I work on the XAML design tools for both Blend and Visual Studio. For the next few minutes, I'm going to take you on a demo of a few different features that we've enabled to help boost productivity in working on XAML apps in Visual Studio and Blend. Let's get started. So here I am in Blend for Visual Studio 2013, and I've created a brand new grid app. Now the grid app looks very similar to Windows 8, although Blend has changed a little bit. We now have a ruler and a measurement bar associated with the design surface. You can notice on the top and the left the ruler that's aligned to the top left origin of the page. When I click on controls, such as the grid app, I can see exactly where they're positioned relative to the top left corner. Here it shows me 120 pixels, and then it shows me that my text block is now 1216 with the remainder of 30 pixels on the right. In addition to that, we've also enabled guides. Guides help you align content across your page. I can just drag on a guide like this, and I can align it right to content, for instance, around here, which shows that I'm about 120 pixels from the left edge of the screen. I can also save and load guides so they can be used across multiple pages. Getting rid of that guide, I'm going to go into View, Manage Guides, and I'll load a set of guides. We ship in the box a set of guides for every item template that you see. So, picking the grouped items page guides and opening them, we'll now see guides align that show me where all my content should be. For instance, between items in this grid view, I see that I have a guide at 370 and 380, showing I have 10 pixels space between each item. But what I really want is 20 pixels of space. So I can just change that 380 to a 390, and now I need to align the content to that. To do so, I need to edit the template of this grid. So, clicking on the grid view, I can go ahead and we'll edit additional templates. We'll edit the item container style. I'm going to edit a copy, and in this case, I'm going to put the copy in the application rather than the page. And now, there are a few things that are going on that's new to this release. First of all, you see this purple adorner around the design surface. This purple adorner tells me that what I'm now editing is actually not in the current document that I'm viewing. You can also see that app.xaml opened up, because that is where the actual template, the code, is located. And in addition, there's this little icon here, and when I hover it over it, it tells me that this item that I'm looking at is really coming from app.xaml. So let's go ahead and we'll click on this, go down, and we can just increase the right margin, add 10 pixels, and now you can see we're back aligned to this guide. We now have 20 pixels of space between each item. I'm going to switch gears, leave the grid app, and we'll move over to the movies app. This is an app that I'm working on building for the Windows Store. So in it, I have a bunch of movies, and I'm going to make a few changes. The first thing you'll notice about Visual Studio is that we've redone the device pane. Rather than simply have all of these properties listed at once, we've now organized them in categories that tell you what we're actually previewing. For instance, are you previewing a change about the device itself or about the operating system? I'm going to take the theme and I'll change it from dark to light and simulate the app moving into the light theme. As soon as I do so, you can see that I've updated the background, the movies appear in this box, but I've lost the logo. So if I come in here and let's click on the logo, you can see that the fill is actually just a hard-coded color. Unfortunately, that won't work when the background changes from dark to light. So I'm going to go into the brush, and let's just convert that to a new resource. So we'll convert it, and we'll call this the movie logo brush, and I'm going to store that in the application. So now, rather than having a hard-coded brush, I now have a resource. I can navigate to this resource if I want to see where it's defined by simply right-clicking and go to definition. This will work for all data bindings as well as resources. Hitting go to definition takes me where this brush is defined in app.xaml. Now, if I want the brush to be different colors, both in dark and light, I really need to put that in a theme dictionary. So I'm going to just delete that brush for now. Let's go to the top, and I have a little code snippet I'll just grab, or rather, fragment, drag it on in, and I now have that same brush, movie logo brush, defined as one color in dark and one color in light. Returning back to mainpage.xaml, as soon as it loads, I can now see, let's deselect it, that it's dark here, and when I switch to the dark theme, the brush now shows up properly. Oops. Oh, there we go. Now shows up properly there as well. Okay, now switching a little bit more, I'm going to take this, and I want, when you click on this movies, we want to navigate to a page. So I'm going to take this view box, right-click, and I can say group into, and I'm going to group into a border. Now, because I really want the behavior of clicking on something to actually do something for me, I'm going to rename that border to button. Now, when I select border and start typing, One of the new features that we've added, as you can see, is while I type, the end tag down here also updates. So I don't have to type in both places. Now I have a button. Now let's go over to this grid view. Speaking of the additional features that we've added in the editor, we're going to talk about IntelliSense here. I have this item source binding, and in the past you would have to type this by hand and know what you're being bound to and just type it and hope that you have the spelling right. I'm going to delete it and let's just add it again. So as I start typing at item source, I can then type binding, which brings up IntelliSense, and in this case I want source to be bound to a static resource. So type static resource. Now as soon as I hit space, we see a list of all of the available resources appear, both system resources as well as local resources. I want the grouped items view source, so I hit it, hit enter, and now as the binding is complete, the movies appear again. If I want to have more context on what this actually is, I can just click on it, hit F12 or go to definition, and it'll take me right to the collection view source defined above in this document. Now if I further wanted to investigate what's going on and I see that it's bound to model, I can hit F12 on model, which will take me to the definition of model that's defined in app.xaml. Now if I really wanted to understand what is model, I can again hit go to definition and it will take me directly to the class. I see it's a movies view model. Backing out again, we return to mainpage.xaml, and in this case we'll play around a bit more. In addition, I'm bound to this property, groups, that's defined on the model. So if I hit F12 on groups, it will take me to where that property is defined right here in the code file. Let's try something else. In this case, I have items path. If I didn't understand what that was, again, I can hit go to definition. It'll back me out to the object browser because this is defined in the platform and give me some information about what items path accepts. In this case, it's a property path. Let's return to mainpage.xaml. And before, you had to simply type this by hand. Now, if you go over to the property inspector, we now have a dropdown. And this dropdown will show you all available properties for whatever type you're bound to. In this case, groups. And groups has a property called items. All right. I'm going to add a new page now. So let's just go down in my views and I will add a new page. Right click, add new item. And in this case, I'm just going to add a basic page. Hit basic page, hit add. A basic page has a few components, a back button and a title. When it loads, you can see that the back button, which is before just a styled button, is still a styled button, but now it has this navigation back button normal style defined on it. Again, if I navigate to it, it'll take me right to generic.xaml, and if I hover over that, I can see that this is actually coming from the Windows platform. This new style ships with Windows 8.1, and I can again look at the definition of it. Let's go back to basic page, and in addition to just some new styles that Windows ships, we also ship a bunch of new controls, such as a date picker and time picker. Two highly anticipated controls people have been asking for. Can drag on a time picker, search again, and I can also drag on a date picker. Now, the date picker has a few interesting properties. For example, this calendar identifier is just a string, and you have to know what available strings there are for this property. But we've also added them to this dropdown, so if I really wanted a Japanese calendar, I can just select it, or I can switch back to Gregorian. We've also enabled this in IntelliSense. So in addition to the calendar identifier, there's also another property called the month format. Now the month format again takes a string, and you need to just remember what these format strings are or look them up. We've also added those to IntelliSense so that it can make it much easier for you to remember what these are. For example, if I wanted to say instead of September, just 09, I can hit enter, and it'll autocomplete that syntax for you. There are a few other controls that we've added. If I add a button, one of the things I might want to do on a button is have a flyout appear saying, hey, when you click this button, you're not quite ready to do something else. Give you some more contextual information. So I can right-click on the button, hit Add Flyout, and immediately it asks, where do you want to create the flyout? I'm just going to create it in this page. And as soon as I hit OK, I now have a flyout. I can design this, I can style it, just as I would anything else. I'm just going to add a button to it. And when I'm done, I can leave flyout editing scope, just like a template, return back up, and the flyout disappears, allowing me to design my page. If I ever wanted to return to design that, I can come down. I see that the button now has a flyout associated with it. Scroll down. So I can right-click on the flyout. We'll just say Edit Flyout, Edit Current, and now I can return to editing this flyout. Now one other control that was added was a command bar. In the past, we had app bars, and app bars are basically containers that just allowed you to put content into it. Windows also added a command bar, and this command bar can be used in place of one of those. If I return back up to my page route, I can just take a command bar and drag it down and place it in the bottom app bar property. This previously only worked in Blend. We've enabled it in Visual Studio. So as soon as I add that, let's zoom out. I'm going to hit Control 0 to zoom and see the entire page. I can click on the command bar and see that it automatically appears. Now in the command bar, I have two collections, primary commands and secondary commands. Another new control that was added was the app bar button. So I can just right click, we'll just add a button. I can even right click and let's say add a separator and then add a toggle button next to it. Now if you wanted to then design these buttons, we can select one. We're going to zoom in, click here, say fit selection on this button, and you can see that a symbol appears. Now we're going to edit the properties of this app bar button. So when I click on the app bar button, we have a new category editor that you can see here called icon. Looking at icon, I have a few properties. For example, there's a symbol. I can change this emoji symbol and say if I wanted to just put forward, it will automatically update for me. All of these symbols ship as part of the Windows SIGO UI symbol font, such as map. If you needed to have your own symbol that wasn't available there, you could add your own font, add a bitmap, or even just specify a path and then give it your own data. There's one other control that we wanted to tool, and in addition to all these that you've seen, this is the settings flyout. The settings flyout is actually really just its own item, just like a user control. So I'm going to right click, we'll add a new item, and when I do that, hit Windows Store, we'll scroll down and I see the settings flyout. Now I'm going to just call this for now the update settings flyout, and hit OK. And this would be, for instance, when you invoke the charms bar, so on the right side of the screen, go over and hit settings, it would be one of these things that fly out when you click one of these links in your app. So now that I have this settings file, you can see it's generated some code for me, and in addition, it's given me some UI. I'm going to zoom out on that, let's fit all, and you can see that it's about the width of a proper settings flyout. Now returning to the code, the next thing we need to do is hook this up so it actually works. I'm going to build this, and then I have this documentation link. We'll just click it. This documentation link will come into settings flyout. I can scroll down, see all the documentation about the different things I can do with it, and in addition, there's some code here on how to hook it up. Given that I want this settings flyout to appear for all pages, I can just copy that code, go to app.xaml so that I ensure that the settings flyout is registered with Windows when the window is created. Scroll all the way down to the bottom, and let's just add that. I can just copy it in, and then to actually register it, I just need to grab this one line of code, copy, return to app.xaml, and paste it when the window is created. My settings flyout is now wired up, and all I have to do is go style it. From here, we're going to switch back to Blend. So let's save that. We'll switch over to Blend and open to the same app. Here we are. We'll let it reload, since we added a few files to it. And as soon as it reloads, we're going to hook up that button. So when you click on the movie's title, it actually takes you to that new page we added. Now to do that, we added one of the most highly anticipated features that people have been asking for, behaviors. So now when I click this button, what I really want to happen is I want it to just go to the basic page. So I can go over to Assets, when I do so, hit Behaviors, and go add, let's scroll down, and navigate to page action. I can just drag it onto the button, oops, and I missed, so let's undo that, and in this case, I'll drag it right to the button. So here I have a navigate to page action. I can just grab this action, drag it right out on the button, release it, go over to target page and set it to, let's say, main page. And now when you click that button, it'll automatically navigate to that page. So these have been a few great features that we've added that will really help you boost productivity in working with XAML when building apps for both Windows Store, WPF, Silverlight, and Windows Phone. I hope you enjoyed seeing them and enjoy building apps.